Hi, everybody. I'm glad you're with me. I'd like to talk to you tonight and share with you some thoughts from God's Word about apostleship. And this is specifically from the New Testament of God's Word. Have you ever heard people say, "Your church is not organized as the early church was. Where are your apostles?" Very interesting question. So I'd like to bring about what God has to say about the apostles. Jesus spoke about them before he ascended into heaven and went back to the Father, and that he chose 12 men to be his spokespeople here on earth, and he called them apostles. And so I'd like to share what God has to say. I'm going to break this down in about 5 subtopics so we can focus more clearly on what their task was, what their purpose was, what they were assigned, and how they were able to do God's work leading the church into the future from the first century and beyond. So let's get started with the study. If you don't mind, I really appreciate your time. Thank you very much. Well, this question that I spoke about where is your apostles, this question comes up, and it's a puzzling thought. There are several denominations who claim to have apostles, especially among the charismatic groups. And so with this thought today, I believe these kinds of claims just cannot go unchallenged. We in the body of Christ need to address this, and we need to try to understand how to present God's case to these false teachings of apostles in the church today. So I'd like to start with that the apostles were witnesses. The word apostle refers to a person who is sent as a messenger. It particularly applies to a group of men sent by Jesus Christ to serve as witnesses. When Peter and the other apostles presented the first gospel sermon, Peter stated, "This Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses." This is in Acts chapter 2, verse 32. The witness was not merely testimony about their personal beliefs. These men testified about the events they personally witnessed. What was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life, and the life was manifested, and we have seen and testify and proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested to us. What we have seen and heard, we proclaim to you also, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. These things we write so that our joy may be made complete. This is in 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Being an eyewitness was a crucial qualification for apostleship. When Judas Iscariot had to be replaced as an apostle, the remaining apostles looked for men who were present with Jesus. Therefore, it is necessary that of the men who have accompanied us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning with the baptism of John until the day that he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. This is Acts chapter 1, verses 21 and 22. It was a man's ability to provide eyewitness evidence regarding the resurrection of Jesus that was of primary concern. Peter confirmed this when speaking to Cornelius about his duties. And he said, "We are witnesses of all the things he did both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They also put him to death by hanging him on a cross. God raised him up on the third day and granted that he become visible, not to all the people, but to witnesses who were chosen beforehand by God. That is, to us, who ate and drank with him after he arose from the dead." Acts chapter 10, verses 39 through 41. This testimony to the reality of Jesus was so important, Jesus promised to send the Holy Spirit to help the apostles accurately recall what they had seen. Reference John 15, verse 26 and 27. The Holy Spirit also provided the apostles miraculous powers to confirm their testimony. Acts 4, 33. God also testifying with them, both by signs and wonders, and by various miracles, and by gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will. Hebrews 2, 4. It is important to understand that these men were not self-appointed missionaries. They were sent by Jesus Christ himself, hence the name Apostle. Acts 1 verse 8. Sometimes people speak of witnessing for Christ. Technically, we cannot be witnesses. We were not present when Christ walked this earth. We did not see him die. We are not witnesses of his resurrection. We can speak of Christ. We can give evidence of the change in our own lives that came about when we followed the blessed teachings. However, we cannot be witnesses to the events of the first century. We cannot prove that Jesus is the Son of God, as the apostles did in the beginning. They were able to offer their personal testimony concerning the things they personally experienced. The next section is the apostles were the founders. The apostles had other duties beyond serving as witnesses to Jesus. They were a part of the foundation of Jesus' church. Notice Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 through 20. They brought the early church into existence and taught the disciples how to become Christ-like, or Christians. To accomplish this task, Jesus gave them authority to issue commands on behalf of God. "Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven." Matthew 18, 18. Most translations do not express this verse as clearly as the New American Standard. Jesus was not saying that the apostles could create any law they desired and God would go along with them. The phrase, "shall have been bound in heaven," is in the past tense in the Greek. The things they were to bind on earth were things that have already been bound in heaven. They were not creating laws. They were passing on the laws of God with the authority Jesus granted to them. Reference 1 Corinthians 14, verse 37. The apostles were full representatives of Christ to the people. How they were received directly reflects on how these people would receive the Lord Jesus. "The one who listens to you listens to me, and the one who rejects you rejects me, and he who rejects me rejects the one who sent me." This is Jesus in Luke 10, verse 16. The authority they held was not their own, but the delegated authority of the Lord. For 2 Peter 3, verse 1 and 2. Hence, when their teaching was accepted, it was accepted as God's own words. For this reason, we also constantly thank God that when you received the Word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as the Word of men, but for what it really is, the Word of God, which also performs its work in you who believe. 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 13. The 27 books of the New Testament are the result of the apostles' work, and they form a permanent record of God's teachings. 1 Peter 1:23 through 25. This combined work contains everything we need for life and godliness. 2 Peter 1 verse 3. It equips us for every good work. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Once it was handed down, there would be no need for any further revelation. The apostles wrote their testimony so that their joy would be made complete. 1 John 1, verse 1 through 4. Beloved, while I was making every effort to write you about our common salvation, I felt the necessity to write to you, appealing that you contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all handed down to the saints. This is in Jude 3. Next, we want to talk about counting the apostles. As I mentioned earlier, Jesus personally selected 12 men to be his apostles. They were named for us in Luke chapter 6, verse 12, and 16. When Judas committed suicide after betraying the Christ, another apostle was selected to take his place. Acts 1:20 through 26. When looking for qualified men, the disciples were able to narrow the field down to 2 men. However, they knew they could only select one. It was important that the number of apostles remain at 12. Hence, they prayed to Jesus to select the proper replacement and drew lots, confident that it was actually Jesus who was doing the selection. It wasn't much longer before another apostle died. James was killed by Herod during the early persecution of the church. Acts chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Yet prior to this, Jesus had selected Paul to be his apostle to the Gentiles. Notice Acts chapter 9, verse 10 through 16, and Acts 22, 12 through 16, and verse 21. From Paul's statement regarding his selection, it appears he did not assume his duties immediately. Galatians 1, verses 15 through 19. Men have always questioned whether Paul really was an apostle. His selection came much later than the other men, and Paul was not one of Jesus' disciples while he was here on earth. Paul argued that he did not come to his position because he was trained by other men. Galatians 1, 11 through 12. He points out that the remaining apostles and leaders in the church recognized Paul as an apostle. Galatians 2, 6 through 10. We even have Peter's own testimony of his acceptance of Paul. 2 Peter 3, verses 15 and 16. Paul met the qualifications for apostleship. He was an eyewitness of Jesus' resurrection. Notice 1 Corinthians 9, 1 and chapter 15, verses 3 through 10. He was able to give proof of his apostleship by the signs God gave to accompany him. 2 Corinthians 12, 11 through 12. And Paul considered himself to be the least of the apostles, not because of a lack of ability or authority, but because he had fought the Lord in the past. He felt he wasn't worthy of being called by the Lord, though he deeply appreciated the gift given to him. Hence, Paul could justly claim that he was called to be an apostle by Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 1 verse 1. Therefore, we read that the church was founded on 12 apostles. Revelation 21, 14. 14 men held the title of an apostle, but essentially there were only 12 at any one time. Were there other apostles? Were there not other men who were called apostles? Well, yes, there were. You must remember that the word apostle was not created for this particular office. The office was called by a Greek word that was already in existence, the Greek word for a sent messenger. For example, we can read in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 23, "As for Titus, he is my partner and fellow worker among you. As for our brethren, they are messengers of the churches, a glory to Christ." The word translated messenger in this passage is the word apostle. Why then was it translated messenger instead of apostle? Because the verse tells us that Titus and the others who accompanied Paul were sent by the churches. The original 12 were sent by Jesus Christ himself. The two replacements were also selected by Jesus. But these men were sent by the churches. Hence, the context dictates that the word is being used in its common sense and not in reference to the office. Similarly, Epaphroditus was the messenger of the Philippian church. Philippians 2 verse 25, even though the word used in that of an apostle. What about Barnabas in Acts chapter 14 verse 4 and verse 14? We know Paul was sent by Jesus, but here both Barnabas and Paul are referred to as apostles. If you turn back to Acts chapter 13 verses 1 through 3, you will find that Paul and Barnabas were selected by the Holy Spirit and sent on their mission by the church in Antioch. Both men were sent messengers, but it does not necessarily imply that both men held the office of apostle. There is no evidence that Barnabas was selected by Jesus to be his messenger and witness. We have no evidence that Barnabas was an eyewitness of Jesus. And even though Barnabas is mentioned several times in the scriptures, there is no other reference to Barnabas being numbered among the apostles. Given the lack of objective evidence, we cannot prove that Barnabas was an apostle of Christ. It is just as likely, and even more likely, that Barnabas was a messenger of the church. Then you may say, well, what about Silas and Timothy in 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 1 and chapter 2 verse 5 and 6? The appropriate question is, was Silas and Timothy included in Paul's "we" in 1 Thessalonians 2:6? In the same letter, we have Paul making this statement: "Therefore, when we could endure it no longer, we thought it best to be left behind at Athens alone. For this reason, when I could endure it no longer, I also sent to find out about your faith, for fear that the tempter might have tempted you, and our labor would be in vain." This is in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verses 1 and verse 5. Please observe that Paul used the plural pronoun "we," even though he was talking about only himself. Hence, just because Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 2:6, "Even though as apostle of Christ we might have asserted our authority," we cannot necessarily infer that Timothy and Silas were included in that "we." Even though Timothy and Silas are frequently mentioned in the scriptures, we never find the title apostle attached to either names. This lack of evidence greatly contrasts with the frequency in which the 12 are referred to as apostles by themselves and by others. Then there is the case of Andronicus and Genius in Romans chapter 16, verse 7. Great Andronicus and Junius, my kinsmen and my fellow prisoners, who are outstanding among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. Translators and commentators acknowledge that the phrase outstanding among the apostles could be read two ways. It could mean that the two mentioned were outstanding apostles, or that they were well known by the apostles. If it is the former, then we are left with the puzzle of why two well-known apostles aren't well known. This is the only mention of these two in the scriptures. If any two apostles were to be called well-known, it would be Peter and Paul. Instead, it appears we have a case of two Christians who were well-known to the apostles. The phrase is similar to saying, Nurse Jones is outstanding among the doctors. The phrase does not imply that Jones was a doctor. There is one other apostle mentioned in the Bible, though he was not one of the 12. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of a heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession. Hebrews 3, verse 1. Jesus could be called an apostle because he was sent by God, just as Jesus sent the 12. Reference John chapter 20, verse 20 through 23. He served as a witness to the Father, John 14, 9 through 11, speaking as an eyewitness, John 6, verse 46. So now we come to the thought of, what about modern-day apostles? If Paul could be an apostle after Jesus arose, people wonder why the apostleship cannot continue. First, there remains the problem that the Bible speaks of 12 apostles. Second, no one today can serve as an eyewitness to Jesus. And third, all who were selected as apostles were chosen by Jesus Christ. No method is recorded in the Bible for the training of new apostles. In fact, Paul's argument that he was an apostle rested on the fact that he was not trained or selected by men. Again, in Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 through 12. Fourth, there is a distinct lack of proof that men today are apostles. Where is the evidence of signs which prove apostleship? A notable sign was the ability to pass on the gifts of the Spirit by the laying on of the apostles' hands. Acts chapter 8, verse 18. Paul even showed this ability in 2 Timothy 1, verse 6. Today, we have claims of such an ability, but there has been no proof whatsoever. And finally, Paul called himself an apostle born out of due time, 1 Corinthians 15:8. Think on what this implies. There was a season when apostles were selected. Paul was an unusual case. He was an exception to the rule because he came later than the other apostles. If apostles were to continue to appear, then Paul's case would not have been unusual. He would not have been born out of due time. Obviously, there was a limited season for apostles to be on the earth. God warned us that there would be false apostles. Their deeds would demonstrate them to be false. 2 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 13 through 15. When tested, they would be shown as false apostles. Revelation 2, verse 2. When a man falsely claims apostleship, he does so to gain authority with the church. By claiming to be an apostle, he claims the right to teach his own doctrine, and that doctrine will necessarily conflict with the proven doctrine already delivered by the apostles. Galatians 1, verse 6 through 10. Hence, we are warned to test every spirit. 1 John 4, verse 1. Just because a man claims to be an apostle does not make it so. Well, I hope this has helped you understand a little bit more about apostles and their original purpose and meaning, and that there were only 12. There will never be any more apostles until we meet again in heaven with the Lord. And by then, we will all be brothers. So thank you very much for your time, and may you be blessed in your studies. Good night.